Hello. So today I'm here to talk to you guys about this masterpiece right here, Dune by Frank Herbert, and display this phenomenal edition that I am so glad to own for my collection. This is a bit of an overwhelming video for me to sit down and try to film and collect my thoughts about everything that I've read. And there's a lot of reasons for that, which we'll get into, but it's the case where I texted my friend Nick, who loves this book as well, right before sitting down to film, and I was like, I don't even know where to begin. I will start by saying that upon finishing the book for the first time, I immediately gave it a 4.5 out of 5 stars. A couple weeks have passed by now, and at this point, it's really leaning more towards a 5-star read. I don't think I'm gonna say it's a new favorite 5-star read until I reread it again, which I absolutely will be rereading it probably relatively soon into the new year. I will say that at least for now, it's a 4.75 out of 5 stars instead of 4.5, leaning more towards that 5-star rating for me. So let's start at the very beginning. The dedication for this book is to the people whose labors go beyond ideas into the realm of real materials, to the dry land ecologists, wherever they may be, in whatever time they work, this effort at prediction is dedicated to humility and admiration. Immediately upon reading that, I was like, I already like this. So you guys might not watch my vlogs or really know about my passion for caring for the environment. I am a vegan. I am shifting towards a minimalist lifestyle with as close to zero waste as I can be as I move to my new home. I care immensely about protecting our planet as much as possible because humans are disgusting and we are destroying the only place we have to live, and the earth will live on far beyond human beings. So that immediately, you know, got the wheels turning, thinking like, okay, what is this going to play a role in the story? Or I kind of want to know more about Frank Herbert just because of this statement. So before we get into all that, I'll just say this is a spoiler-free review, but for those of you who don't know and maybe are just interested in possibly reading Dune for the first time, Dune was originally published in 1965. I thought it was interesting to find out it was originally published as 2 novels in a magazine. I always love knowing how classics originally came about. And upon doing a bit more research, I realized that he was basically thinking these ecologists, at one point he was working or observing ecologists trying to control the dunes in Oregon by planting grasses. We know how that works. And so I just thought that that was a really interesting and a unique aspect to add to this sci-fi story that was a partial inspiration. Now there's also Arthurian legend inspirations. There is discussion about this being inspired by Beowulf. One other thing that I hope will maybe interest you in picking this book up a bit more is some of probably your favorite things out here have strongly been influenced by Dune. Obviously, a huge connection we can probably all make if you're a Star Wars fan is Star Wars. Have you heard of Tatooine? There's way more than just that, but I freaking love Star Wars more than I can tell you. It brings me so much joy. So to know that a piece of Star Wars came from this book makes me love this book. A Song of Ice and Fire and the feuding houses. Where do you think a lot of that inspiration was drawn from? Dune. Wheel of Time. We actually had a pretty good discussion about which groups of characters in Wheel of Time, the Aes Sedai specifically, and other characters, what they were inspired by in Dune. And I truly believe that. Without doing further research to confirm that, it definitely feels that way. And then something that I was so excited because I am a metalhead. I freaking love metal. And I get really excited about music and bands. And when I was doing some research just of things that were inspired by Dune, the amount of metal bands that took inspiration from Dune, I was just like, I didn't know that. And it made me so happy to see. I love when there's little connections like that. So there's a good chance that some of the things in fantasy and sci-fi that you love in present day or within the time since 1965, there's a real good chance that it was inspired by Dune. So if that alone doesn't make you want to pick it up, I don't know what will. I think that's why I loved reading the Lord of the Rings trilogy, even though it was kind of hard for me to get through, to be honest. I loved seeing where a lot of the fantasy inspiration came from. And I feel like that is the same thing with Dune. It's important to me as a reader to understand where a lot of things got their original inspiration. So maybe that entices you to pick it up. Should this just be called You Should Pick Up Dune? But this is a more of a soft sci-fi story that rather than exploring the technological side of sci-fi, it addresses politics and humanity, more specifically the human condition and moral dilemma. And I think that's why it appeals to me so much, because I'm a character-driven reader and this analysis on human society was so well done. So we're in this sci-fi world set in the future, in this society where various noble houses control planetary fiefs. Our main character, Paul Atreides, and his family have to leave their home planet and go to Arrakis, which has basically uninhabitable living conditions for human beings. It is so hot and dry. It's a desert. There is almost no water to be found. And so that is why water is so sacred in this world. On this planet of Arrakis, melange or spice can only be produced there. So it's very coveted to have power over this planet and society, because spice extends life, enhances mental abilities, helps with other technological things. It's very coveted to be in control of it. So really we're following the feuding houses for control over this important planet where spice can be found. And within that feuding between the houses, there's a lot of betrayal, a lot of twists and turns, and exploring a lot of really cool ideas that seem more like magic than sci-fi ideas, in my opinion. But either way, I'm happy to have them both. I think this is a good mix of fantasy and sci-fi, in my opinion. And that's why I would say if you are newer to the genre of sci-fi and you like reading fantasy, you could probably start with this book and really enjoy it. Now, I procrastinated reading this book for so long because I heard it was really hard to get into. I had heard, honestly, mostly negative reviews for this book. And so I was kind of put off from it. And then the movie was supposed to come out on my birthday, and I'm devastated because I knew I had been planning for months to read Dune in November in preparation for it coming out on my birthday in December, and then we were all let down, and that's not going to happen. I will say that I think that my experience was greatly enhanced by me having the ability to see the Dune trailer before reading the novel, because those images in my mind helped so much. I have no doubt I would have loved the book without having seen that prior to reading it. I think it just enhanced my experience. And in the Patreon Discord, we were talking about the same thing, and it was fun to sort of like see the actors and actresses who were going to play these characters and compare them to what we had in our mind. And having those images really did help paint a bigger picture of things, I think. So that is the quickest synopsis I can give you to hopefully spark your interest in this story. It is very character driven, in my opinion. If you have been following my channel or know much about my reading taste at all, you know that I love Malazan Book of the Fallen. And I especially wanted to prioritize reading Dune after my interview with Steven Erickson, when he told me that so much of his inspiration came from Dune by Frank Herbert. And I was like, what? And I haven't even read it. And we'll get into all the things that Dune has inspired later, but I was just so fascinated by that because I love the way that Steven Erickson writes his books, how much is left to the unknown, how much piecing together of things that you have to do. And you see that right away within Dune. And I actually have a quote from his son, and he just said, "Dad told me that you could follow any of the novel's layers as you read it and then start the book all over again, focusing on an entirely different layer. At the end of the book, he intentionally left loose ends and said he did this to send the readers spinning out of the story with bits and pieces of it still clinging to them so that they would want to go back and read it again." And let me tell you, he was absolutely successful in accomplishing that task, because you have your initial feelings when you finish this book and it sticks with you. And that is something that is so important for books that are 5 stars or books that are favorites, is they stick with you and you can't stop thinking about them. And I promise you, that is how you will feel. Well, that is how I feel, and a lot of us feel after finishing Dune. You can't get the story and the characters and what has just happened out of your head. You need to keep thinking about it. And that's why I'm already going to reread this story very soon so that I can continue on with it, because of course I need more from this world. So I think it's very well known that this is a very thought-provoking book that discusses a lot of really important themes, and that is one of the biggest strengths of this book, Frank Herbert's ability to fully explore and discuss these themes and topics that he wanted to place importance upon, and he succeeded at that. He did a great job. We have a lot of themes discussed here. I would say one of my very favorite is human control over ecology. So reading about the influences of Dune, we know that the lack of water on Arrakis represents the shortage of oil and other resources due to overpopulation. So he is directly, way back in the 60s, relating this sci-fi world to problems that we are already seeing in the 60s. And big surprise, here we are years later, suffering from all of these conditions being just worsened. I'm very passionate about the exponential growth of the population of the world, which we are destroying. There's not a lot I can say in this video about that, but our resources are going to run out. And that is a theme that Frank Herbert wanted to discuss at length in this book and explore what would happen if we don't have water anymore. And some of the processes that they go through in this book just to preserve water or conserve water, and what it means when somebody actually sheds tears for someone because you're wasting water at that point, or having to conserve water with it that you sweat out of your body, basically. He really goes into detail and does a phenomenal job of making you really feel the scarcity of this resource and how important it is to them, the suffering of them not having it and the lengths they have to go to preserve it. He doesn't half-ass anything in the book, and you're really able to fully grasp the harsh realities of this planet. And just a couple things that mean so much to me. This was the first grand scale planetary ecology novel, which obviously had a huge impact on a lot of things. And it strongly influenced a lot of environmental movements, which, like, I just absolutely adore that with my passion for the environment. Combining that with my love of reading and an author who is passionate about those things, it just doesn't get better than that. A major theme in this book as well is religion, and I know that Frank Herbert really wanted to melt a lot of religions together to sort of do away with that separation of only the one way is the correct way by melting a lot of influences from different cultures together, which I really appreciate. We also see how religious influence has so much control over everything with the Freemen and the Bene Gesserit. I always love religion explored in my fantasy and sci-fi books. I know some people don't love that. I personally do. And we also have this ongoing theme of free will versus fate and having the ability to foresee what's going to happen in the future and figuring out that no matter what you do, you can't change that outcome. What that means, are your actions controlled? Are you controlling your own actions, or is everything just going to happen the way that it's going to regardless of your choices and decisions? So I loved the exploration of that. And then also kind of with fate, and we have this like selective breeding to create, the word is slipping my mind right now, but I don't want to spoil anything either, but the person that they were breeding to create who's supposed to save Arrakis from its harsh conditions and make it habitable to humans. I would say my other favorite theme explored in this book is like the chosen one or heroes. And it's really kind of turned on its head. So I can't remember if it was an interview with his son or with Frank Herbert himself that was saying he drew inspiration from the Foundation trilogy by Isaac Asimov, which is a favorite classic sci-fi series of mine. But this time the mule is the hero, not the Foundation. I love turning that trope upside down and what he did with it in his book to sort of change perspectives. I love that. So I'm just going to read a couple quotes again about his views on heroes in general. Enormous problems arise when human mistakes are made on the grand scale available to a superhero. Heroes are painful. Superheroes are a catastrophe. The mistake of superheroes involved too many of us in disaster. I had this theory that superheroes were disastrous for humans, that even if you postulated an infallible hero, the things that this hero set in motion fell eventually into the hands of fallible mortals. What better way to destroy a civilization, society, or race than to set people into the wild oscillations which follow their turning over their critical judgment and decision-making faculties to a superhero. So that kind of leads into how this book really discusses like the downfall of a society and the collapse of a group in power. I think that's something how can I talk about this without spoilers? It's tricky, but I think that that's enticing for a lot of readers to know before going into this book that this really turns that trope upside down and discusses the problem with just blindly following the hero. And we sort of see that by the end of this book, and it makes me very excited to see where things are going in the next book. So I know that was a lot about themes right off the bat, and hopefully doesn't scare any readers away from picking this book up. If anything, I hope that it entices you and makes you excited to read about some of these themes that are discussed, because this book just makes you think so much and parallels what's happening in society today all these years later when it was written in 1965. And it's just brilliant, and I am somebody who likes to read something that just makes you continue to think about it days and weeks later. And that's what he was saying with the layers, the same thing Erickson was saying with the layers. It's meant to be read again and again to fully understand everything that Frank Herbert put into this novel. Since I am a character-driven reader, let's talk about the characters next. This book won't be for everyone because of the writing style. We'll get into that later. But you never feel super close to the characters in their heads, thinking every thoughts. I mean, you get to know their thoughts, but it's almost a detached perspective, which I personally enjoy, and it adds to the tone and the overall feeling of the book, in my opinion. But I know that will put some people off because they need that close feeling to connect with the characters. So if that's you, just be aware of that going into this, that you're not going to feel that. However, these characters really make an impact. And I fell in love with so many of the characters from the very beginning. And I will tell you that I know I will pick up on so many things the second time through. We have this really unique arrangement between the Duke Leto and his concubine Jessica, who is Paul's mother. And they are both very strong characters in their own ways. And they just have so much mutual respect and understanding between one another in Jessica not becoming his wife for political reasons. I love seeing just the portrayal of the relationship for what we got in this book. I really appreciated it. There are characters that you're supposed to hate, and let me tell you, you will hate them. It's not like I kind of love to hate that guy. No, it's like, die, please, now. I hate you, you are the worst. And I love when an author can make me feel that much emotion towards a villain, because I feel like so many villains are written pretty mediocre these days. This villain, I hated. I just wanted him to die. These are not all cut and dry, black and white, good or bad characters. There's a lot of morally gray characters. There's a lot of conflicted characters, characters who might be a little more self-serving and want to look out for themselves, or characters that can be convinced to betray other people. So that's all very interesting to add into the character work. These are not two-dimensional characters whatsoever, in my opinion. They're really well-realized characters, and I don't think there was anybody that stood out to me as somebody that I thought wasn't well done. And then there's the obvious Paul. Paul is one of my favorite characters that I have read about in so long, and he will absolutely make my next favorite male character list, because watching his transformation, shoot, I need to look again from the beginning. He's maybe 15. I don't know. He's a young teenager in the very beginning. And this book spans a pretty decent amount of time, and that's one of the issues I had with it. But oh my gosh, watching him from the beginning, that initial scene with the Gom Jabbar, and you know, him just being like, I don't even know what's going on right now. Sure, whatever, let's do this test. I don't know why you have to do this to me right now. And seeing his character arc and transformation and growth by the end was unbelievable. But let me tell you, that's maybe not the right word, because it was done in a believable way. And that's what's so important. It was very genuine to the character and to the story, and it was believable, but it was so extreme, the changes that were made. And clearly there's a lot of reasons for that, but oh man, did I love sitting back and watching it happen. Paul is such a strong, like, mentally stable, even-toned character, and there's a lot of reasons for that as well that I won't get into for spoilers, but he just does what he has to do, and just so even-keeled, like, just can't be bothered. Just, this is what we need to do, we're going to do it, and doesn't let emotions get involved or get in the way. And I love that about him, and it was so interesting to see the transformation happen from a teenager to this person who's not even very old still by the end of the book, make those changes and just buckle up and do what he had to do for the sake of the greater good. Oh my God, I loved it. And he is somebody who we really explore his feelings at certain times because of circumstances, I can't say, of not being able to feel certain emotions all the way. And that really bothers him, but he recognizes it. And I loved the exploration of that. Okay, let's get into the plot. So a lot of people complain that not a lot happens in this book, and I think that's false. I know that I'm a very character-driven reader, so I don't need a super go-go-go action-based book. I actually do not prefer that, so maybe that's why. But I will tell you, I was not bored reading one page of this book. In fact, with it being the Patreon buddy read, I read it so fast that everybody was like, girl, why did you do that? And I'm like, I don't know, man. I couldn't put it down. It's not my fault. The book was so good, I had to keep reading it. And I'm gonna try not to do that next month, guys. Sorry. But I was never bored. There was never a stretch of time where I was like, I don't really care what's going on here. Let's get to the next section. Not at all. I think that it was very engaging. It has so much political intrigue. It focuses on politics so much and exploring the fall of an empire and these houses struggling for power amongst one another. I think part of what made the plot so good for me was we had this really great mix of science and ecology mixed with politics and religion that were driving the plot forward at all times. It was always something, whether it was something to do with the ecology of this planet, something to do with the religion aspect, with the Bene Gesserit and their customs, or something to do with political ascendancy to power. I don't know. I'm not good with like terms like that, but basically who's the heir, who's going to take the place of the current ruler or emperor. There was always something. And for me, it's so great when it's a mixture of a lot of different things. And that's what makes me never be bored, because we have ecology, we have the science, we have the politics, we have the religion / magic sort of aspect. So I was never bored. I think the overall plot of what is being accomplished throughout this novel was superb. I have no complaints there at all whatsoever. I'm not gonna touch too much on the world building because I already talked about that a bit before, but I think it was very well done. And being a fan of Steven Erikson in the Maelzrom books, you're always having the feeling of wanting more. And that is true for this entire book. I wanted more information. I wanted to know more about the world. I wanted to know more about these houses and the history of them. I wanted to know more about the ecology of the planet. I wanted to know more about the history of the families. So that might be somewhere that it lacked just a tad bit while reading. But if you read the preface or whatever the introduction is, and then you have to read all of the appendixes at the end. Appendices? How do you say it? Why am I dumb? Like, I don't even know why I talk about reading or books. So if you read all of them, I promise you, you get 90% of your questions answered. Let me just pick up the book, okay? Let me tell you right here, right now. Plus, there's also a terminology of the Imperium in the back too, which like, use it, man. Use it. That's what it's there for. So, Appendix 1, The Ecology of Dune. I mean, it's quite a few pages long. Appendix 2, The Religion of Dune. You're going to get your questions answered. I promise you're going to get more information than you even thought you would. Appendix 3, Report on Bene Gesserit Motives and Purposes. I bet you wanted that while you were reading, right? Appendix 4, The Almanac and Ashraf. Selected excerpts of the noble houses. Terminology of the Imperium. So I know that might put some people off from enjoying the book because you have to reference things in the back of the book as you're reading or wait until after. I waited till after to read each appendix. And actually, I didn't know there was the terminology in the back. I had a lovely subscriber tell me like what four terms meant prior to reading it when it was on my TBR, and that saved my life. And I put that in my Discord for everybody to see while they were reading, and I know it helped them. So I can understand that there are readers out there who want all of that information as they're reading. They want to take the time to have those info dumps and the world completely fleshed out while you're reading. I am somebody that I'm totally okay with. Let's roll with it, man. Okay, here we are. We've got what we need. You're going to give us a little more. Let's keep going. You're put into this moving train as this book starts. Things are already set in motion. We're already on the path we're going to be on. And now let's just ride with it. Okay, that's how I felt. And I like going back and learning more details afterwards. I'm totally fine with that. If you're not, just be aware of it going into it. But I will say, if you don't read those, you're going to feel like there's a huge missing piece of the world building, but it's all right there. Now, the other thing that I personally loved but could deter other people from reading this is the writing style. I personally think that the prose is stunning. I think that it's almost ahead of its time, but it is classic sci-fi. I have experience reading very dry classic sci-fi, and I'm okay with that. If you are newer to the classic sci-fi genre, it might put you off a bit, but I wouldn't let that deter you, because in reality, and discussing this with a good friend of mine, it really feels way ahead of its time. It feels very relevant. It feels like it could have been published today, and it doesn't feel outdated at all. So personally, I loved the way that it was written. I think that it completed the book. I think that this story told through a different writing style wouldn't be as impactful. And lastly, the pacing. I feel like I could ramble about this book for so long, you guys. The pacing, in my opinion, for the most part, was very even, and I was okay with it. Now, this is one of the biggest critiques I had, and this is being nitpicky. Sometimes I'm a fan of time jumps in books, and sometimes I'm not. And there was one part at the end of, I can't remember, if it had to be book two. There's a significant time jump, and it states it, but then there's a couple events that take place at the end of chapter two, or at the end of book two, and you know that a lot of time had to have passed in order for these processes to occur, but it doesn't tell you. It just says, this happened, bye. And then it says, okay, 2 years later. And I was like, what? What? And at this point, I was like, is this really happening? Is this a vision? Is this a prediction? Where are we at? How are these people here now? How old are they? And I wanted more detail of that time passing. Sometimes I think things would have been a little bit more impactful if we saw them being fleshed out and explained and watch these characters go through these events rather than just being told what happened. That was my biggest critique of this book, were those time jumps. And for me, this book felt really short. I think it's just over 600 pages, which really is not a short book. And I was just having an argument the other day about how I don't want every book to be so long. This book would have benefited from being a tad bit longer, in my opinion. Maybe I won't feel that way upon reread. Maybe it will all be there and be done just perfectly. I can't say yet because I've only read it once. And when the author tells you something is not only meant to be read once, well, there you go. Read it again and then find out. So I can't say that definitively, but I just wanted a bit more at times. And that's pretty good if the only thing that you're able to criticize about a book is wanting more from the story. All right, we've touched on the themes, the characters, the pacing, the world building, the writing style, plot. So I just want to end with a statement by Frank Herbert. In 1979, he said, "The bottom line of the Dune trilogy is beware of heroes. Much better to rely on your own judgment and your own mistakes." He wrote in 1985, "Dune was aimed at the whole idea of the infallible leader, because my view of history says that mistakes made by a leader or made in a leader's name are amplified by the numbers who follow without question." And that's one of the biggest themes discussed in this book, which is why I freaking love it. I love to see the demise of a character and what happens, and that's what, spoiler free, makes me really excited to see where we're going in the next book. I love when things don't turn out peachy perfect, and yeah, you get some of that in this book. This book has such a strong, impactful, epic ending, in my opinion. I know that wasn't totally popular across the board with the readers in the Discord, but man, this just packed a punch in the ending, and I was like, oh, damn, okay. So I don't really know what else to say other than I'm going to keep rambling forever if I don't stop talking about it now. So I'm sorry if this kind of fell all over the place. I wasn't planning on doing a review, actually. So I didn't take notes while I was reading it because I didn't know I was going to love the book so much, but I really don't do a lot of reviews unless something really is impactful and stands out to me. And Dune absolutely does that and belongs on the list. So I wanted to go back and at least put some initial thoughts. Maybe I'll review it again after I reread it and dissect it a bit more and do like a spoiler review. But I wanted this to be an analysis that people can watch if they are deciding whether they want to pick up Dune or not, because I have so many subscribers who comment and say they're not sure if they want to read it. And hopefully this discussion can help you decide if you want to pick it up or not. So with that being said, let me know. You've read the book. Do you agree with what I said? Do you disagree with it? What is your favorite or least favorite part about the book? If you are here and you haven't read it and you're thinking about reading Dune, are you more inclined or less inclined to pick it up now? Hopefully more. And I would just love to hear your guys' thoughts in general. Once again, sorry if this was all over the place. I'm bad at book reviews. Why do I have a book review channel? I don't know. But I'm excited about Dune and I can't wait to continue on with this. So thank you guys for watching and I will see you next time.